There's no doubt that violence against women and girls is a huge public health crisis around the globe. Girls and women aged 15 to 44 are more likely to be killed or maimed at the hands of men than die from cancer, malaria, and war combined.
I first read the book Half the Sky a few years ago when it came out, and I consider myself educated, but I was really shocked at what still goes on in the world regarding women. It made a huge impact on me. I love what Nick and Cheryl say in the book, that women are not the problem, they're the solution.
Is this your first time in Africa?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I've been in Morocco, so I've been
okay.
In West
On this trip to Sierra Leone, we've invited Eva Mendes to join us. I've been to West Africa many times, and I'm hoping that she will see things differently in ways that will complement my own experience.
Sierra Leone is so overwhelmingly new to me. I'm just seeing poverty, heartbreaking conditions to live in.
Sierra Leone went through absolute hell, but it really is making progress.
I really like Nick. He's a great mind, and he's a truth seeker.
It's beautiful.
When did the war end?
In 2002. And although the fighting ended, basically everybody goes on raping women. When you have a kind of civil conflict and norms about sexual violence change, and so it becomes okay to rape. And then when the war ends, it's no longer acceptable to shoot people, but somehow it still is acceptable to rape.
My hope and motivation in coming here was working with women, and especially little girls. I'm a girl's girl. I have so many women in my life. Before coming here, I definitely thought, well, I was excited to meet the girls. I relate to struggle, and I relate to meeting challenges. It's gonna be tough, though. It's gonna be really hard.
In the world of sexual violence in Sierra Leone, there are plenty of villains, but there are also some heroes, and one of those is Ami Kande, who works with the International Rescue Committee. Ami's fortress is a rainbow center, which is a place running a program for victims of sexual violence.
Welcome to the rainbow center. Really, they're primarily responding to rape. We provide specialized medical treatment and counseling.
Yeah.
We've seen over 9,000 survivors within 8 years. 52% that are between the ages of 12 and 17. Then you have about 26% that are under 12.
Under 12?
Yes.
26% are under 12?
That are under 12 years old.
Trend is we see more and more children, about 80% of our clientele. We see an average between 100 to 200 a month. And they are as young as 2.5 months old.
Excuse me. Sorry.
We have a 3-year-old that has just come in for follow-up, and I'm almost wondering if she could dialogue with you guys.
Yeah, it's a 3-year-old.
It's a 3-year-old girl who has been raped, and she's just come back for follow up. Yeah. You want to come with me?
Okay. What is her story, very briefly?
She's actually, they don't know who the perpetrator is, but she was getting sick, and they took her into the hospital. And that's when it was realized that she has been abused, but because they have not been able to see who it is, know who it is.
I can't even fathom, like, how somebody could even just hurt a child, but how they can commit such an aggressive sexual act against them.
This is Jessica?
Hey, Jessica.
Hi, Jessica.
How you can rape a child is beyond.
So hi, Jessica.
Yay!
It's magic.
Okay. So Jessica is doing much better now.
I mean, why? Why? I think with the why, it's really just about what's been in place for so long. It's accepted. The women live in fear. And the men, they don't see consequences to their actions, so they're just like, you know, they keep doing what they're doing.
How are you?
Come on in. So this is Sister Mafinda.
Nice to meet you. I'm Nick. So how often do you see sexually transmitted diseases in girls who've been raped?
90%.
90%?
Mm-hmm. A lot of the girls that come through this Rainbow Center, that incident is what has brought them to the Rainbow Center.
Right.
But it's not the first time they have been abused. Really, when you look at the root cause of violence against women and girls, it's about power and control. But there is a myth. For people here, having to vaginate somebody is a pride. So as a result, they don't care how young they are. And because there is no really recourse in terms of accountability, it's become acceptable.
This is the police station?
Yeah, this is like the family unit at the police station.
We're gonna go meet. The family support unit, because there's a young lady named Ilamatu who has been raped by a family relative who is also a pastor. It seems pretty positive because both her parents want to arrest him and press charges. That's not very common. And hopefully justice will be served.
Hi.
Hi. You are welcome then at the FSU.
Hi, I'm Nicholas Christoph. Nice to meet you.
This is the family support unit. We investigate sexual offenses, domestic violence, physical abuse on children. It is our mandate.
Hi. Nice to meet you. I'm Nicholas. Hi. Nice to meet you.
That was already in our hospital. The hospital will tell you anything.
My name is Fulema Tawagali. I am 14 years old.
What class are you in?
Form 3. Form 3 is 9th grade.
You reported to your mother?
My uncle, Victor Palmer, raped me.
And it was one act
it
or
has
it
been
was ongoing?
He did lock the door and threw me at the bed. He don't fight up me.
He actually grabbed her, pushed her on the bed, and I'm like, did you scream? She said I couldn't scream. He had covered my mouth, so I was unable to scream.
And he had done this to other girls?
Yes.
Mom said a lot of kids. How old is Kenneth?
So they 10, 12.
10, 12?
When the first one says they were not too big, they are not strong. But they are small, small beginning.
Me, I feel say if I tell her, they will do me bad, beat me. So now my friend no more, I tell.
This is dad, you want to push small? Me, are you small girlfriend? This woman said, they say you don't cry a lot. And this now you only got picking up. They tell them, you say you don't get seven picking, that this is the only one, right?
I believe decision for going to police. They look at us in a shame thing. Because like my uncle, so we do that this so, and the family, all my children, like me so ashamed. Because I need to add you go now, they go and talk about my name.
I'm wondering with your girlfriends, your school friends, is this something you feel free to talk about?
I tell them, so it's a man and nobody again. Okay.
And what did your friends tell you? What advice did they give you?
Advise me, say with him, talk to me for
I just think you're so brave for doing this. I'm talking
Her uncle is not a blood relative, but here, the way it works, as long as you have actually been a family friend, you are now really by right. That's how it is here. You are now a family member. So technically, still, he is an uncle. And he is a pastor.
For a teenage girl at the bottom of the social spectrum to challenge and accuse a man more or less at the top of that local social spectrum is an incredibly gutsy thing to do. And she must know there's a good chance that it may not work.
So I want now to go to the home and arrest this perpetrator. We want the perpetrator now because the medical is in progress.
After hearing the charges against the pastor, we went in search of him with the police. We approached the house and it turned out that he was not there. Do you think that if we go to his church, I mean, can you find his church? Do you think he'll be there or not? Well, we were obviously afraid that if more time goes on, that he'll hear that the police are looking for him and he'll run away.
Let him give him, okay, give you his number so that you can ask if he's in the church.
Yeah. At that point, we asked, could we call him? Everybody said that that would scare him off. He would wonder about the call, but Fulamatu actually suggested that if a foreigner were to call him, he would not be suspicious of that. He's not going to think that, you know, some foreigner is a policeman.
Is this Victor?
I explained that I was visiting America and that I'd like to see him. He was suspicious. He wanted to know how I got the number and so on, but we managed to talk around that. We have a friend in common who suggested that I meet you. I wondered a little bit about the propriety of that. Does a foreign reporter get involved in a police action against somebody? If you have time, I could come on by and say hello. It seemed to me that on balance, you know, journalist helps capture alleged child rapist. That isn't really something to be too embarrassed if that comes out.
Okay, so why don't you come with me, because I want you to be in the car in case he calls again.
He agreed to meet me. He was traveling across the city. We went to where he was going to meet. Then got a call that he's right there in the street. We went out to look for him. Suddenly, there he was right in front of us, but in handcuffs.
Pastor, now you're on that.
As far as I can tell what happened, one of our camera crew security guys was with Fulamatu's father and spotted him and grabbed the pastor right there.
To this hour, this last minute.
Did you actually see any girls who were 7, 8, 9? Did you see any girls that young go with him into the house?
Yeah.
Just once or many times?
Many times.
He looked really guilty and very embarrassed, and, you know, he could barely put his head up. Fulamatu was so excited, and her father seemed like he was so happy that we caught this guy. It was just this incredible moment of, like, justice being served.
Thank you.
think she needs to understand she has not done something wrong. And when you talk to her, she's like, I don't care which name they call me. Yes, she can say that, but inside, is she burning?
When you hear your neighbors, like you said, provoking you, I know from experience, listening to people say negative things to you is very difficult, but don't give them the power to have that over you. You knew you didn't do anything wrong, and you still believe that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, what do you like doing the most? What's your favorite?
I like to do accounting and finance.
Oh yeah? Accounting?
Accounting and finance. The bank manager, right?
I have a very important question for you. Which necklace do you like better? This one or this one?
This one.
This one?
Yeah. Okay.
I got us both necklaces. If I was supposed to, I give this to you. And you wear it. And you pray for me?
Yeah.
And I wear it and I pray for you.
Thank you.
Oh, it's perfect. Look at that. That is what you're wearing. I need a hug.
The burden is always on the survivor. The perpetrator? No. No. If she wasn't dressed that way, she had provoked him. Remember? What about the perpetrator? He's done nothing wrong. It's the survivor that has that burden to prove herself innocent.
Now, set, eh?
Yeah.
Okay, this is, so you know the seller?
Just this one. 4 yards?
Yeah.
I'll take 4 yards. 1, 2, 3, 4?
Yeah.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4. Thank you very much.
Thank you too.
Ami's incredible. She's one of those women that, you know, you're just like, you just kind of feel a little bit worse about yourself. Going, really? You do that too? Okay, so now I have absolutely no excuse when I go back home because she's done it and she's doing it. And she's incredibly inspirational. She's beautiful. And she still has a lightness about her.
Gender-based violence encompasses a lot of things. Right. Female genital mutilation, child sexual abuse, domestic violence, wife beating.
I would say like between 80 to 90% of women have gone through female genital mutilation.
Well, I have actually experienced violence firsthand. I have been physically abused by my ex-husband. Here it's very common for your husband to have an extramarital affair. And my ex-husband was having not one of them, a lot of them. And when you actually confronted him, he becomes violent.
Before, if you were not circumcised, to get a man to marry you was almost impossible.
If you were not circumcised.
Which was a requirement. But now really with education, it's changing a lot.
So I'll come to the office, I've just been bashed, slapped, I'm not able to walk, I will sit in a corner and I'll start crying. It was ironic because here I was dealing with it, then I was there talking to women as to how to address violence. So I had this double life.
And then when the husband dies, the women don't get to claim anything.
Now the law has changed.
It went on for years. And I remember one time he was just really drunk. And he's like, today, I will definitely step on your grave. So what he's saying to me is that I will kill you. And this is it. And that to me sent a message that if I don't get out, this guy will end up killing me.
Anyway, it brings back memories.
On me.
Yeah.
So really, this job we do on a day-to-day basis is something I can relate to. This is something I have lived with.
Do you know if somebody has one of the investigators searched Pastor Palmer's room?
You know? Investigators are looking here. I've been looking at his performance room. The room is locked.
They don't go to the crime scene. People sit in their offices and they expect to get all the information surrounding the reported incident from where they are seated. So they do armchair investigations.
Maybe we could take the investigator with us and then he could investigate in the room because he has not been in Pastor Palmer's room yet, so we can offer the investigator a ride.
Yes.
So what does an investigator do here?
I'm just going to seize the room where I've seen her.
I see. We went in the room, which actually turned out to be unlocked, and they sort of looked around a little bit. They didn't particularly gather anything, and then went back to the police station.
You don't really see cases going anywhere because the quality of the investigation makes it almost impossible for any supporting evidence. So when they get to court, they are being dismissed.
So in the last year, about how many alleged rapes have you seen here?
Well, you know,
100, 1,000...
For Sierra Leone, the definition of rape is on women, not
okay.
on children,
right.
on a girl child. And she's below 14.
I
we
see.
Cannot charge for it. We just charge for abuse of younger.
I see. When was the last time you had a successful prosecution for either rape or abuse of a young girl from this FSU?
Well... We have the investigator. I'm not prosecuting. We have the investigator.
We only have one, and that was this year.
Okay.
We haven't had any prosecution for a long time
okay.
in Freetown. They have not been committed to High Court, but they have not gone beyond that.
We, as the International Rescue Committee and its partners, have actually responded to about 10,000 sexual assault survivors since we started operations in Sierra Leone. And out of that, there's not even 1%. Of those cases that have been convicted.
It still does seem as if something is wrong if thousands of girls are getting raped and in all of Freetown only one rapist is prosecuted.
From what we are seeing, we just did a survey recently. We did a research from clients within the rebel centers, what is preventing them from accessing and the barriers. They've cited a lot of pressure from either police. I'm not saying it's you. Really, the laws are so cumbersome, and that's why we worked with Baka to develop the standard.
I think Ami is utterly heroic, and she's 1,000 times more effective because she is Sierra Leonean. Because part of the problem is cultural, there is potentially a certain drawback in a bunch of outsiders parachuting in and saying, hey, your culture is all wrong, you've got to change it. It is much more effective if you get a woman or a man coming from within and calling for change. So, Fulamatu says that you raped her.
I did not rape Fulamatu. Fulamatu, I take her as my niece because her mother, she's my cousin. I take her as my cousin. All of us stay together in the house. Normally, I only watch over her, talk to her concerning her education. We live together peacefully. I never raped her.
She has a sexually transmitted infection. Who could have raped her?
Well, I don't know. Because I never did that to her.
Several other girls in the area also say that you attempted to rape them.
It's still, sir.
And the other girls in the community, they all speak of you in that sense. The girls all seem to say that this is a common experience.
I'm not that type of person.
Why? What was the disagreement?
Why?
Because of this sort of process, we couldn't disappoint him.
The child has disappointed the family, and he, as the husband, will not pay the school fees anymore.
So, your husband feels ashamed, feels humiliated, because of what happened to Fulamatu. And so he wants to kick her out.
Yes, I say yes.
But it's not just Fulamatu, it's several girls.
She's an embarrassment. Now, instead of Fulamatu, who is the one that has been abused, now she's been seen as the one that has actually provoked the pastor.
Fulamatu, in your heart, do you think you did anything wrong or not?
Are you at peace to do so a wrong or a right?
Because they don't come with me. They don't go so far in the police. My mama don't can cry. So for me, they left for him to beat me and my food. So me, so me, they do up at the gate. So now I want me to listen.
Well, I just want you to know that you did nothing wrong. Absolutely nothing wrong. And you know, you're incredibly brave and strong, and it breaks my heart, and I just think you're very admirable. So we have a girl who, for being raped, she is about to be kicked out of her house and may lose any further education. And meanwhile, the rapist will get off. It's really hard to find legal remedies to rape when you have cultural attitudes like this, where rape is unfortunate but forgivable, but you're being raped is just an unpardonable sin. Just about everything possible is going wrong. The father has said that Fulamatu, he is kicking out Fulamatu and her mother from the house. Because they have shamed him, and so they don't know where they're going to spend the night tonight. And I just hope that the poor Fulamatu doesn't pay a terrible price for
being brave,
for being raped, and being brave.
I can't imagine what it's like when you feel like there's nowhere to turn and you're a child. You're supposed to be protected. You're supposed to be made to feel safe, no matter what. It's infuriating to me to know that these girls don't have that.
When you rape a girl, you're very often also destroying her future, destroying her capacity to remain living with her family, to be a credible member of her neighborhood, to continue in school, and any hope she may have for a better future ends right there. Fulamatu impressed me with her poise, her willingness to seek a prosecution, to speak out, and it seems to me that that is the missing link. So what we need are prosecutions. We need to send people to jail to protect other girls out there. Fulamatu was willing to do that.
If we don't come on a cell right now, it can do the same thing avoc. Me ne put an idea the QA de tika de tuana sonata segurity for everlasting thing die. Me na for me me talk. I don't care. I don't feel bad as strong. For me not for say, I left for be a good future in life.
It's really disheartening that we are still going through this process. This country, we've come for something terrible. We shouldn't allow the violence that is being inflicted on women to continue. It must stop, because it can stop. Sierra Leone cannot be a better country if women are not part of the solution. always tell people, you never know. Come 2017, we might be running for election just to make Sierra Leone a different place, because I think women have a stake. We need to be able to have our voices heard.
Of all the issues that Nick and I looked at, gender-based violence is the most widespread. In a country like Sierra Leone, it's very extreme. It's a post-conflict situation. But rape and domestic abuse happen everywhere.
You see violence against women in rich places, in highly educated families, in very low-income families, in all regions of the world.
This is not a third world, first world issue. The fact that 3 out of 5 women still get abused in somehow, some way in the world, you know, shows that that fundamental respect that I just don't have the right to do, to touch her or talk to her the wrong way, is still not there fully yet.
If you can't be protected from violence, from fundamental abuse, then the other things you would want to achieve, education, opportunities, they're stolen away from you by the violence. And this is what people need to understand, is that women and girls are just utterly vulnerable in so many of these communities.
A lot of the brutality against girls and women is rooted in deep cultural stereotypes about the worth of women.